Hello, hello, hello. So we're going to go ahead and try to get started. We do have a full house tonight, as you guys can see. And if the RSVPs hold out, we'll probably have a few more people filter in. So we've got the space over here. But we are going to get started because we do have, you know, we've got a couple of presentations, and then we actually have three people set up to do some lightning talks as well. So we should have a nice full slate of conversation. Before we get started, I've got the URL up here for my slides at least. So if anyone's interested in following along, you can certainly do that. And I always forget, so I'm going to say it first so I don't forget. If you parked in this building, parking garage, make sure you talk to the person at the front desk and get a little parking validation card. Don't forget to do that because it costs like $25 when you leave if you don't validate. You get the card, it's only $5. I know we have a lot of new people. I could tell from meetup.com. How many people by show of hands are new to the meetup tonight? Wow, that's awesome. Really cool. Thanks for coming out and braving the Austin traffic and heat. How many people are, obviously, probably almost everyone's here because of React. How many people are actually new to React as well? Wow, cool. Well, Matt's going to give us a cool talk about React and Redux. I'm actually also interested in that myself. I've been looking at React for my company, so I'm in the same boat as you guys. I'm very interested in learning about that. For those of you who are new to the meetup, we do call it Bleeding Edge Web. So the whole idea of this meetup is, you know, there's meetups all around town that are specific to a particular framework or a language, and those are great. We like to be sort of a general purpose meetup that we think would be interesting to anyone who's generally sort of a web app developer type. So we like to mix it up from month to month. We cover lots of different topics. So hopefully you'll find this interesting. And part of what we do is we like to open it up with what we call news from the bleeding edge. That's kind of our recurring segment. So we talk about browsers and frameworks and all kinds of interesting stuff. So before we dive into that, we generally ask if anyone has announcements. So if you're hiring for developers, or if you are someone looking for a job or anything like that, now would be a good time to raise your hand and let everyone know. And you have something, right?
Thanks. My name is Daniel Parker, and I'm a developer here in town. And I just wanted to come out and share the fact that I recently wrote this book, JavaScript with Promises, from O'Reilly. So I wanted to let you guys know about it and encourage you to check it out. The title kind of gives away what the book is about. But it does have some stuff early on about just general asynchronous programming in the event loop. And most everyone here probably knows what the event loop is, but there's still some information there, I feel like, that surprisingly a lot of people don't know and seems to be helpful to people, as well as going into the different libraries, Bluebird, and a lot of patterns you can use with promises. And then it rounds out with some ES6 and some ES7 stuff. And the book was reviewed by Chris Kowal, the guy who wrote the Q promise library, and as well as Dominic Tenicola, who was another contributor and is also kind of key in getting promises into the ES6 spec, and Petka, who wrote the Bluebird library, and then Cody Lindley, who's kind of a prominent JavaScript developer. So it's on Amazon and available from O'Reilly, so please check it out if you get a chance. And there have been a couple of reviews already, some 5-star reviews, but we're trying to get more reviews out there. So if you like it, please add a review as well. Thank you.
That's awesome. If you're doing a lot of JavaScript and you're not doing promises yet, you should definitely check it out. We actually use Bluebird, which is one of the frameworks Daniel mentioned in the stuff we do, and we really like it a lot. Did you say
that? I'm Corey Butler. I actually co-organize this group, and I'm looking for a lot of people at the moment. I got 5 different openings, looking for developers, DevOps, some front-end people, and for any of you that aren't familiar, this group actually grew out of being the Sencha user group several years ago. If there's anybody in here with EXT background or touch or something like that, I am looking for someone in that realm. We also tend to head down to Buffalo Billiards afterwards, after the meet. So I'll be down there, and if anybody's interested, feel free to, you know, hit me up down there and we can talk.
What does your company do?
Well, I'm company is called PeopleForum. We do people analytics, and we're looking mostly for back-end stuff. We're doing a lot of work with Docker, shipping data around, as well as applications around. Front-end side, we're doing similar kinds of things, trying to build out our user interface. So we're pretty new. We got a couple of early clients that we need to be supporting, so that's why we're building up. So.
Cool. Anyone else?
Yeah. I guess.
There's actually people on live stream too, so.
Name's Adrian. I'm an application developer. I have about 6 years of Java experience and about 3 years of professional experience. I'd like to get into do more front end as my job now because I'm currently a full stack developer. I have about 2 years worth of JavaScript experience, and most of that has been using the AngularJS framework, so. That's kind of my go-to framework. So if anyone's looking for a front-end developer, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, anything like that, or even a full-stack developer, you can come talk to me.
Thanks. Anyone else? All right. And of course, like Corey mentioned, we do, at least Corey and I, if no one else, will be over at Buffalo Billiards. So that's also a good time sort of after the meetup to hang around, talk to people. And if you do have, if something strikes you at that point, you can meet people and chat. All right, let's dive into it. Actually, before we dive into it, let's thank our sponsors. So Capital Factory, of course, where we're all sitting. Thank you very much to Capital Factory for always giving us this awesome venue. And tonight, the pizza is sponsored by PayPal. So we've got a couple of folks from PayPal here. You guys are always looking for, like, pretty much year-round, right? Looking for developers.
Yeah, we're always looking for good people. And my team specifically, so we deal the front-end side of PayPal.
Yeah. Use the mic.
So my team basically works on the front-end side of PayPal. So basically the PayPal.com site, place consumers go to actually see what their account's doing, all that kind of stuff. So that's the kind of stuff that we do. So we're definitely looking for people. PayPal itself, we have lots of different groups within Austin, and they're all looking for different kinds of people as well. So I will be at Buffalo Billiards afterwards, so I encourage y'all to come on over after we can talk some.
Cool, thanks Keith. And thank you to PayPal, really appreciate the pizza. All right, news from the bleeding edge. So, if you're at this group, odds are you're probably either a web app developer or some kind of developer that touches the browser in some way, or even if you're not a developer, if you're at all interested in these topics, you probably deal with the browser a lot. So one of the things we do is this browser pop quiz. It's always fascinating to me nowadays, that we don't even really think about the browsers changing day to day the way that they do, but if you're if you've been developing long enough like I have, you remember the dark old days when basically browsers never changed because we only had one or two to choose from. So we do this browser pop quiz. This month we actually had a few changes. It's kind of interesting. So our meetup last month, these were the browser versions. And now these are the current browser versions. So Firefox and Opera are kind of, we'll talk about those. If you weren't here last month, the reason for the little skull and crossbones for IE is we basically decided that as Edge launched officially last month with Windows 10, we've decided to retire our discussions at this meetup of IE 11. So it is officially dead. Thank you. And Edge, of course, I'm actually not sure, is Ryan Joy here? So Ryan's from Microsoft. I was going to ask him. I'm actually not sure how Edge is going to do version numbers. So right now it's just Edge. But I'm assuming at some point there will be an Edge 2. I'm not actually sure about that. So just to run through a few quick highlights. So normally we just talk about stable versions. We don't talk about all the beta and canary stuff because there's a lot of that. But I will just mention a few little things since Chrome didn't actually have a release. So they have a few ES6 features coming out. One of them, I put the little yay because array.prototype.find is actually something that will be very handy. If you're used to doing array stuff, you always have to do like index of greater than negative one, and it's just sort of ugly. So that would be a nice little function to have. Various other improvements, and they always have security fixes and things like that. But nothing too exciting yet. But like I said, we'll talk about that one more next month. So Firefox, as usual, they have been, really for the past year or two, they've really been doing a lot of work in their dev tools, and I've talked about that a lot in this meetup. So if you're the kind of person like me that started off in the old days using Firebug back before we had really any other good options, and then at some point moved on to Chrome, if you haven't really given Firefox a chance in the last couple of years, you might actually take a look. They've been doing a lot of really good stuff with their dev tools. They've also added experimental support for the push API, which basically allows you from your backend to send push notifications to a web app, essentially. So that's kind of cool. That is supported in Chrome as well, so the fact that it's now supported in Firefox moves that forward that much more. And then mostly minor stuff. Firefox, pretty much every release adds various little random like ES6 functions and things like that, most of which don't really impact us generally day to day. But if you're interested, you can take a look at the release notes there. So Opera is not nearly as interesting as it used to be, because Opera, if you don't know, it actually uses the Chromium engine and the Blink rendering engine underlying, which is the same thing that Chrome uses. And so because of that, for the most part, they basically just adopt that engine a little bit delayed after Chrome comes out with whatever release date, whatever features they add to it. So for the most part, Opera's not that interesting, but every now and then they do sneak in some extra stuff. So one of the things that was interesting in this release was, it's actually not a new feature, but it's a new implementation of CSS multi-column layout. And if you're not familiar with what that is, let me get out of this presentation mode real quick. So this is actually pretty cool. So this is strictly in CSS. So it's a flowing column layout that automatically goes from one column to two columns to three columns. And if you do much web development, you'll appreciate how cool that is, because like today, you really can't do that without like a full-blown grid framework, Bootstrap or one of those kinds of things. This is strictly plain CSS in browsers that support it. So that's really cool.
Question?
Yeah.
Does that support inline elements in addition to straight text?
The question is, does that support inline elements? As far as I know, it does support inline elements, as you would expect.
Great.
Okay. And then just other minor improvements that I'm sure none of you care about, since I seriously doubt many of you use Opera as your primary browser. But I could be wrong. Safari. It's kind of like IE 11. It's basically the new IE, which is sad. I leave this slide up. I mean, I know that Apple is not watching this meetup, but I don't know. It's the best I can do to shame them into doing something. Safari 9 is technically coming out at some point. And, the bad thing, of course, though, is that Apple doesn't really tell us what it's going to be. So right now, no one knows if it's going to be useful or not. If you're familiar with, if you Google it, there's a site that people use to look at how browsers are compatible with like ES6 and ES7. And it's by a guy named, he goes by the name Kangax, K-A-N-G-A-X. So if you Google that, it's a compatibility table. And nowadays the browsers are hovering around 50, 60, 70% compatible, and Safari is at like 15% right now, Safari 8. So we'll see what Safari 9 does. So Microsoft Edge just came out, so we actually don't have like release notes to talk about because the whole browser is brand new. But one thing that I wanted to point out, which is nice, is they have this brand spanking new platform status page, which is really cool. They had sort of a version of it before, but with the launch they've updated it and it looks really pretty now. And you can kind of see exactly what they're working on, you can see the priorities of all these features. So that in and of itself is a really good feature if you think about it, because we never had any visibility into any version of IE as far as what they were thinking about implementing. So that in and of itself is really cool. And they did a little blog post that basically outlined the things that they're already in development on for their new version. So again, that's pretty awesome, the fact that they're even talking about that kind of stuff. And I think I have a special slide, yeah.
I just wanted to mention that you can also go vote for the features that you feel passionate about that should be the next in development. Can't remember the exact URL, but if you surf around, you'll probably be able to find it. They're encouraging feedback from people of, you know, what they want right. implemented next.
So the comment is that you can actually, they're supporting voting on features by the public. So if you find the page where they do that, you can actually cast your vote for specific features. So as I was going to say, you guys actually preempted me earlier with the round of applause from the previous slide, but I was so excited about this myself, the fact that we have this new browser, that I have added a special slide just for Microsoft Edge. So that's pretty much how I feel about it, not having to worry about IE anymore. Obviously, if you know, work at a state agency, or there's various reasons why you might care, but I don't care about IE anymore. Libraries and frameworks, there might be other stuff. I didn't like exhaustively search, but these are sort of, you know, I have a list of sort of the main frameworks that people in this room probably care about. And so when those do releases, I, you know, mention them here. So Ember is obviously a popular one, and they just released their 2.0. Bootstrap is a big one, so I actually made a slide for that. Raise your hand if you use Bootstrap. Yeah, I do too. So if you're not familiar, Bootstrap 4 just came out, the alpha version of it, and if you haven't checked it out yet, you definitely need to go check it out. You know, it's not ready for production use yet, but you know, the quote there says it all. They pretty much revamped the entire thing. They dropped IE8 support, which could be a big deal for some people. They've moved completely away from LESS to SAS, which is obviously a big deal. They've revamped a bunch of their components. One thing I thought was really cool is all their JavaScript components and plugins are now written in ES6, which that's really cool. We talk about ES6 a lot in this meetup. So the fact that a framework like Bootstrap has basically jumped right off the deep end into ES6 is pretty neat. And actually even more stuff than I even have on this slide. It really is, I mean, it's kind of scary. If you use Bootstrap currently, it's kind of scary to see that first quote, but there is lots of cool stuff in it, so you should go check it out. And then if you are into Node at all, the convergence has officially begun. So we started off with Node. Node sort of split for kind of political and other reasons into Node and IOJS. Now they're actually coming full circle, and what's interesting is the official Node now is going to be based on IOJS, which was based on the original Node. So it's done this kind of big circle. But officially now we have this new Node repo, which was based on IOJS. And as the quote there says, all future releases that anyone cares about with Node are going to be coming from this repo. So good news in Node world. Trend spotting. So this is just sort of, as I was like looking through things this month, and especially what brought this up really was React. We're going to talk about React later, Matt is. And one of the things that comes up lately is this concept of declarative data management. So as you can see, you know, if you do any kind of serious development, application development, you typically run into these kinds of problems with data. Not problems necessarily, but you know, patterns that you have to figure out, problems that you have to solve. So, you know, dealing with remote versus local data, for example, in offline situations, things like that. You know, when to cache your data, when to invalidate cache data, how to best optimize your requests based on request size, based on number of requests, and that's kind of related to this graph retrieval. What that means is, you know, typically data models aren't just a simple request for one thing and get back one thing, right? More and more these days we deal with graphs of data, interrelated data models. So it gets to be challenging sometimes how to optimize a request for a chunk of data that has to touch 10 different data models, or maybe 3 different physical databases, you know, things like that. So in line with the React talk, Facebook actually just publicly came out with this framework. It's actually been, I think, in use internally for a while, but just a couple of weeks ago, they published Relay. And so that's basically their concept for declarative data binding to React. I don't think it actually is specific to React, but obviously it works really well with React. And the whole idea is basically, you know, instead of having to write your own custom like Ajax code and binding callbacks and populating fields and things like that, the whole concept of this is you basically declare the data requirements of your components. And then it's sort of like a set it and forget it kind of thing, theoretically, where, you know, the framework itself actually takes care of transmitting the data to and from the server. It handles transparently figuring out if the data is already local or if it requires a network request. It handles data consistency, again, which has to do with whether or not like your request succeeded or failed, whether it needs to be retried. All kinds of really cool stuff that we do have to all deal with in our applications, but when you have to deal with it manually, it can get pretty tricky, right? And sometimes we don't even deal with that stuff at all. Like some people don't really deal with offline, for example. So this gives us a really theoretically easy way to deal with that. I say theoretically because it is currently in tech preview, so I haven't personally used it. I would be interested if anyone has played around with it. By show of hands, has anyone messed with it yet? Yeah, it's pretty new, so. There's also Falcor. Anyone remember this movie? Yeah. So that's Falcor the Lucky Dragon. I don't know if that's why they picked the name, but this is Falcor. It's actually a framework by Netflix, another big open source library company. They've been putting out a lot of cool stuff. So interestingly, it kind of addresses the same problems. You know, if you think about Netflix, like when you read through the reasons why they built this library, they have the exact same problems I just described. If you think about a Netflix screen, you know, on your TV, when you load up that screen, I mean, think of where all that data is coming from, right? You have the movies themselves, which are probably coming from some database. You've got your personal recommendations, which are coming from some other data store somewhere. You've got all kinds of metadata and all kinds of stuff. So they basically talked about that, like, you know, again, coming back to the graph concept, right? It's not a simple get one thing. It's like get this whole graph of stuff from somewhere and somehow pull it back to this one client endpoint. So that sounds a lot like, you know, the GraphQL is Facebook's version of that. It's essentially the same problem. And they call it a virtual JSON graph, but it's very similar. They have also an object-oriented approach. You know, on the Relay side, it's also object-oriented. So they have this concept of basically tying your data definition directly to your React component, and it's all componentized, and the data binding stuff is all built in. Kind of the same thing here. You've got object-oriented getters and setters on your data models. You have, they actually call it routing, data routing. So it's the same concept as like URL routing, but you can actually write routes into your data by specifying like paths, right? User.name.whatever. They consider that to be a route. And then that route can get applied to the client if you have the data already, or it can be passed as a URL route and handled on the server. And again, that's all transparent to you, which is really interesting. So, and a side note, as I was reading about this, they're actually using React themselves in production, which I thought was interesting. And again, this one is also in developer preview. So, like I said, the concept is obviously very new, and I wouldn't necessarily tell you to run out and install it and start rewriting your apps today. But, you know, it is very interesting and definitely something to keep your eye on. And especially, you know, we're talking about React tonight. So if you're, you know, if you start developing with React, you definitely want to keep an eye on Relay and GraphQL, because as things move forward, those might become sort of influential patterns to follow with React. So I won't reread all this stuff, but you can see kind of what that's all about. And then I have my slides that didn't really fit into any other section, so I kind of throw them at the end. I saw that actually just today, Uber launched an open source presence, which I thought was kind of cool. So we talk about these companies that for several years now have had really strong open source offerings. And actually PayPal, they have a lot of cool open source stuff as well. But Uber is kind of, it's kind of random at first, first blush. But if you think about it, these guys are solving really challenging technical problems at really large scale, right? So it kind of makes sense that they're probably internally building some really interesting stuff. So they just released these two libraries today. They, you know, they sound pretty fancy, so I don't know how applicable they would be to you today, but it's definitely one to keep an eye on. See what else they come up with. And then this actually has nothing to do with anything we're talking about, but I thought it was really interesting, and maybe I'm late to this game because they've actually been around for about a year now. Has anyone heard of this, Firefly Space Systems? So you guys, we have a rocket ship company in Cedar Park. I'm not even kidding. So you guys have all heard of SpaceX and Blue Origin and the ones that everyone knows about. But this company is actually in Cedar Park, and they're employing like a couple hundred people, and they're actually hiring engineers. So I think they're looking more for like embedded systems and that kind of stuff. But you know, if you know someone, it sounds pretty interesting. And you can actually, if you're interested in putting something into orbit, they have a payload user guide that you can read the requirements and sort of put your plan together and get something launched. So I'm like, wow, they're literally like right up the road. Who knew? Upcoming events, so we've got this Austin Diversity Hack. It's actually going to be at Capital Factory in a couple of weeks. It's a pretty general purpose hackathon. So it's not like you don't have to build a diversity app, I don't think, or anything like that. It's just that they're trying to bring a lot of people in to get interested in tech. So I thought that was kind of a good event. There's also, if you're interested in Angular, which is kind of fits in with the React theme for tonight, there's a virtual conference on Angular coming up in September, and it's fairly cheap. So if you are interested, that might be something good to check out. They haven't really posted too many of the actual, what the presentations are gonna be. So you might wanna hold off before you spend the money, but it's one to keep an eye on. And by the way, if you're in the back, there are seats up here if you wanna sit down. Feel free to come down to the front. And then this one is kind of interesting because I haven't seen another hackathon quite like this. There's actually a hackathon coming up specifically about Austin Creeks. So again, who knew, right? So this organization wants to basically build a website and then some kind of web platform to basically serve Austin Creeks in some capacity. So if that's in any way interesting to you, you should check it out. And I think that's it for me. So with that, I will have Matt come up here. Where did Matt go? Matt, are you ready?
Yeah.
So let's hear about React.
My name is Matt Bao, and today I'm going to be talking about Redux. But before I talk about Redux, I'm probably going to need to cover some of the baseline of React. So that'll be probably half of the talk is React, and then the rest of the talk is going to be on Flux and Redux. So what is Flux? Flux is a tool for handling application state. And Flux was built to do that in a reliable way that simplifies the mental model. But before we cover any of this, let's go into React, because Flux and Redux really, they can work without React, but they work best together. They're designed to take advantage of the things that React offers. So React allows you to describe what goes on the page. It's how the pixels get on the page. You do it through a language called JSX. And that's like a mix between JavaScript and XML. So you write XML directly in the JavaScript, and it transpiles to regular JavaScript. And the basic building block of this are components. And components allow you to put components inside of them. So you can have components within components. So it's very composable. You can build really large components, really simple components. And this is an example of a React component. And let's take a look at the code. So this slide is a React component. So if I update this, the slide updates. And what it's doing is here's a render method. Sorry, this is using ES6 syntax. So the render method is really important. It's really the foundation of a component. It says what it should look like. And what it's doing is it says there should be an H2 with a React button. And what is a React button? It's a div with some styling, a button with high. So if I change this, that also changes. What if we wanted this to change, right? This does nothing when I click on it. But to get it to change, you need to call render again. But how do you call render again? How does render work? So initially, when the component is mounted, render is called, and it gets onto the page. If you want to re-render that component, you call setState on it. And another way that render can be called on it is if the parent component gets setState called on it, which will then trigger re-renders of the children. So here's an example. This is a component, and a component has state and props. State is like what clothes you're wearing. What does your hair look like? You can change that stuff. But props are like genes. Genes that are handed down from your parents. You cannot change those. Well, you're not supposed to change those. So when I click on this component, I'm gonna call setState on this and increment the child comps by one. And what that's gonna do is call a re-render, but now the state is different. It has one in it, and that produces a child. And in the render method, I pick a random color and hand that down as props to the children. So every time I call setState, I pick a new color, as well as increment the child comps. So you can see here, you can create a bunch of components, and the cool thing about this is it's really only one component. I'm sticking the same component inside the same component over and over again. But really what this slide is supposed to show you is that the relationship between parent and child. So when I click on the parent's color is tomato. When I call setState on that parent, its children, these two blue ones, are gonna change. But nothing else in this thing changes. And you can do that on down the line. If I wanted to change tomato, then I need to call setState on the parent, the root component, right? This big one. And you can see all of the colors change, even the children within inside those parents change. So that's the relationship of state and props between parent and child. That's it's going to be really important here in a sec, because you really want to cede control of your application state to your parent. That might not be your direct parent, but it's your parent. It's your parent in some form. And what that does is create a single source of truth. If your data only comes from your parent and nowhere else, you just look to your parent to see where that data should come from. Okay, so let's make this button do something. Where's Robert?
Hi.
Oh, there you are. Sorry, I need someone to open my... Okay. So what are we doing here? Oh yeah, so we're gonna call setState on the component now. Also, this is kind of boring. There's only one button. So let's get more buttons. Okay. So in the React button, we're calling setState in the click handler. Why is my mouse working? Okay, so setState toggles the isActive to true or false. And so each button is maintaining its own state. But what if we wanted to do something different where I click on one button and the Redux button also highlights? That's slightly more difficult because the state is being held in each one of these components. Each one of these components knows nothing about its siblings. So in order to do this, you would need to trigger a set state on the parent component, which contains all of these buttons. So instead of this, we take out the set state from the button itself. And instead, the parent has the handle click. And in this handle click, we're calling setState. And it loops through all the buttons. And if the index matches and or the button text is Redux, then we'll toggle the state. And we're passing down the click handler to the child. So now, when I click on this, Redux does what the last click does. But that's a fairly contrived, simple, and stupid example. We'll get into something more difficult later. So also what React.js provides you with, like some of the cooler parts, is efficiency. And that's achieved through the virtual DOM. And basically what's happening when this gets transpiled to JavaScript, it retains an in-memory version of what the DOM should look like. And when you call render, it performs reconciliation, which is a fancy word for it looks at what it thinks the DOM should look like and what the DOM actually looks like, and it batches statements to update the DOM. So you're ceding control of DOM, imperative DOM manipulation to React. No one likes updating the DOM manually, so give it up to React to do for you. And it's gonna be more efficient. And if you do everything through React, through re-rendering, then you won't have bad state. But this reconciliation still comes at a cost. And one of the lifecycle methods allows you to escape a re-render, and that's called should component update. So on the update cycle, when you're calling either set state or the parent is calling, or the parent gets set state called on it, and the children are updating, should component update runs. And it's a function, and if you return false, then it escapes the re-render and doesn't even do the DOM diffing, doesn't do reconciliation. And so that's the best case scenario, right? Because you don't have to do anything. It's cheap. So this is a common implementation of should component update. React has a pure render mixin, and this is what it does in the should component update. It assumes that your component is made up of props and state, and only that. And it compares the props that it has with the props that it's going to get, and likewise for the state. And if none of them have changed, then you don't need to re-render because nothing has changed. So that's what this does. It returns false if nothing has changed. So here's some React references. Some of the finer points of React that really helped me understand why it's useful and why it's powerful. Okay, so now for something slightly more complex. So here's a component, this is not a component, this is just an image taken from Amazon.com. But what if we wanted to do something more complex, right? So these components here, it's hard to see where the parent is, where the common parent is. You can't really store state in the components, in parent components well. So for example, when you click on the add to cart, it takes the quantity and then it adds it to the cart quantity. But you can't really do that efficiently in a huge application just with parent props. So what do? You put it in some other place, a store, you store the data in the store, and you update the store. When the store updates, it fires a change that updates related parts of the UI. Let me just reload. Okay, so this is Flux. You send an action through the dispatcher, and the store says, do I know what to do with that? If it does, then it updates its data, and when the data updates, it calls a handler that the view has registered with the store. And this is a simple unidirectional flow where data only goes one way through the system. The view never goes backward and updates the store. That simplification, while it seems rigid, ends up helping you in the long run because it's simple to think about. But what does this look like in actuality? Well, you have many stores or many actions, and you also have many stores and a whole lot of views. And an action can propagate through the system, and it goes to all of the stores, but really only some of the stores perform an action. And then based on those actions, views get updated. But sometimes with derived data, you need a store to update before another store. And that's where the dispatcher has a wait for method. And this gets complicated because one store has to wait for another store updates. And when you have a lot of stores, that gets complicated. So this is what a Flux store looks like in pseudocode. This is taken from the Flux example in their repo. And it initiates on instantiation, it runs an init method, and then it also has to register with the store its callback, so that when an action does go through the dispatcher, it knows what to do. And then when it is finished with that update, then it emits a change and calls the handlers that the view has bound to it. And sometimes the view gets data from the store, so it gets exposes get methods. So in Flux, the store is doing a whole lot. It's doing more than anything in Flux does. And that's where reducers come in. So this is getting into what Redux is about. So a reducer is a function that takes in an accumulator and a value and returns the accumulator. So in initial state, a value on what to do, and then it returns a new state. So that's kind of abstract. Let's look at an example. So if I supply the initial state of, like, is the light on, true, and then the light status is turn the light off, then I return is light on, false. Or a message list, I append a new message on to a copy of that message list, and I return that copy. So this is what a reducer looks like. This is a stupid reducer because it just returns the state. Nothing happens when you run this reducer. But if you add a case statement and you look at the type, then you can create a copy of the state that you provided and append the new message onto it. And so that's what it's about. So reducers and Flux produce Redux. The parts of Redux are actions, middleware, reducers, and stores. And what does that look like in the data flow? This was the Flux. This was just a reminder. So this is what Flux looks like, and this is what Redux looks like. And at first glance, it looks more complicated. There are more blocks. And let's go through the actual case when you have this. So notice that there's only one store. You never touch the store. You write reducers which transform parts of the store. So when you send an action, it goes to the middleware, kind of like the dispatcher, and it goes to all of the reducers. And that might seem inefficient at first, but I'll explain what the inner workings of the reducer. It's really simple, actually. And all of these reducers produce a copy of the large single store, and is overwritten. The store is overwritten each time. But most times, it's only a part of the store that's being updated. The rest is references to the original state of the store. And then it goes to all of the connected views. And that might seem really inefficient also, but if you adopt the parent component, it's called smart components and dumb components. So if you cede control of the actual state to the parent, you only have a few parents, and you have a lot of dumb children, dumb child components. So this might look crazy at first, but it's gonna play out. So understanding the reducer mirrors the store. So in Redux, you write all these reducers, and when you instantiate a Redux store, you take all of those reducers and produce a root reducer, and that contains all of the reducers referenced by keys. And in the store, your data is also referenced by those exact same keys. And so when the reducer is called, the state that it is provided is the data from the store. So it's not, it's only the reducer only modifies a specific portion of the store. Okay, so the main concepts of Redux is that it only has a single store and state is read-only. You never modify the data in the store. The only way to do that is through an action and the reducers that you wrote to transform that data, which spits out a new copy of that data. It's not a mutated, you don't mutate that data. And that's what reducers are. Okay. So it might seem like the single store is crazy. But the case for a single store is that any of the components that need access to the app's state has access to the entire state. It's like querying a DB. Like, you want the flexibility to hit any part of the DB if you want to. And it seems crazy, but only the smart components, only these special parent components, Flux calls them controller views. Some people call them smart components. Some people call them higher order components. These components are responsible for fetching the data. And so there are not that many of them in an application. And this reduces the need for derived data, because now that you have access to the entire store, you can pull in data from wherever you need to. And you don't need the dispatcher's wait for, because you don't have derived data. You don't have to wait for anything. And this goes along with maintaining a single source of truth. It's also good for asynchronous calls, because when you have calls that are coming from everywhere, sometimes you need the flexibility to check if some sort of state has been set, like someone has already initiated the call from somewhere else in the application. So you don't need to make that call. And you do that through the Redux thunk middleware, which I might have time to go into. And it's also good for server-side rendering, because all of your state is in a single store. You just call getState from that store, and you have the dehydrated form that you need to send down to the client to perform rehydration. Okay, so, sorry, I need to grab it again. This is a demo I prepared to show you what Redux can do, and also to write some simple actions and illustrate the data flow in Redux. Okay, so I made this thing called IGParks. I was just thinking, like, I wanted to see the national parks and see the Instagram photos from those national parks. But there is no national park thing in Instagram, so I built this. So at the login screen, well, when you first get here, it knows you're not logged in. So it prompts you to log in. And a user could click, no thanks, I don't want to. But navigation through the app is not disabled. You can still see some things, and maybe you can entice the user to actually log in. So when you click to this route, it says, sorry, you need to log in. So if you click log in, it takes you to the Instagram authentication API. And you provide it a callback You provided a callback, not a callback, but a redirect URI. So it's going to hit this auth result URI with the response, which is an access token. I'm going to save that to local storage and then redirect the user back to the initial page that they were trying to look at. The network's slow here. Okay. So as you can see, I've been logged in. This is my username and my avatar. And I was navigated to the original page that I was trying to look at. And so that is shared mutable state across different routes. And now you can see that the follow buttons appear. And I can follow different places. This is unlike Instagram where you follow people. In this app, you follow places. And like any to-do app, you want to see if the filter works, right? So you click on following, and because the application state is held in a single store, there's no room for duplication of that data. And also, search works the same way. This view shows that I'm following those four parks. So that application data is being used here and here. So if I click on this, I can unfollow from here, and that's persisted to this also. What I want to do is build this like thing. So if I go here, I try to like this, nothing happens, right? I get this little thing down here that says like parked photo. But that's because it's not doing anything right now. This is what the click handler is doing. It's just console logging like parked photo. So let's trigger the actions. So if is liked, then trigger add liked with data. Else trigger, wait, if it is liked, oh, sorry, the opposite. So if it is liked, remove it. If it isn't, add it. So when I click on this, I get an error. It says, action is not a function. Well, I didn't write the action yet. So let's write the action. So here, an action creator, returns a simple object with a type and a payload. And we'll do the same for remove liked photo. Okay, great. Now when we click on this, what happens? Oh, good. We see that add liked photo is being triggered. But the UI is not updating. What gives? Well, there's nothing to receive it. This is the reducers for the likes portion of the store. And what we're doing on these events is we're just returning the state. But we don't just want to return the state, we want to append the photo. And on remove, we want to filter. So state filter photo. return photo.d is not equal to action.photo.id. Okay. Well, what happens when we click on the photo? Well, nothing happened again. But wait, I think something did happen. Look, I have a likes in the array, so something did happen. If I click on another one, let's look at the store. Oh, look, I have two, so it's working. Great, but what's the problem? Well, the view has to listen, and it is listening with this connect. So this is from React Redux, and what connect takes as its first argument is a select function. And the select function is passed the global state every time the store is modified. But we're returning false all the time. We don't want to return false. We want to see if the photo matches what's in the like store. So let's find state dot likes. And we'll return that value if photo dot ID is equal to props. This is the props of the component props dot photo data dot ID. And if we find something, return true. If not, return false. And if everything works, we should see the UI update. And again, because the store is a single store, I get this for free. It's already there. I didn't have to update anything. So that's the demo. It's fairly simple, but it does show you that you can write Redux in your code. It's actually not hard. And what time is it? Do I have any more time?
Yep, you got a lot of time. 8:08.
What time does it end?
How much are you planning on talking?
Well, there are some more advanced concepts.
No, that's fine. We have 3 lightning talks, but those are only like 5 or 10 minutes each. So.
Okay. Well, who wants to see the rest of the slides?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. So, what I was using earlier, I sort of like hand waved. It's React Redux, and it used to be part of Redux. But as with the case of a lot of libraries, they split it up and take only like the salient portions and make them into their own libraries. So what does connect do? Well, this is how you use connect, right? So there are multiple ways of using connect. You don't have to use it in this form. It also takes 2 other arguments if you want to get specific with how the select works. And there's also another library that provides the memoization if your select is really complicated and you need to like cache the result. This is what links the component to the store. If you notice, in here, I'm really not writing class park photo extends React component, because I don't really need that stuff. I rely on the connect component to be my smart component. and I mainly just write dumb components. So connect connects me to the store. And the select statement pares down only the parts of the store that I'm concerned about. And that gets passed, that gets injected as props. And that's what should component update sees, is the props. And if the props haven't changed, then don't re-render. And that's a huge efficiency gain because you don't have to go through reconciliation. It's, yeah, it's expensive. And it also injects dispatch into props, so you can dispatch actions. If you have a component that needs to dispatch something, but isn't concerned with what updates is happening to the store, you don't have to specify any select in the connect statement, and you'll only get dispatch put in your props. And this is also where you can derive data. You can really customize the shape of the data that your component sees. It doesn't have to look like what's in the store. It can look entirely different. Like, this is like the thing is not even in the store. We derived it from looking at the current component props and diffing that against the like store. Okay, so middleware was pretty simple. It's just a dispatch which sends the action to all of the reducers. It sends it to the root reducer, which then calls all of the reducers. So middleware sits between sits right before the reducers. So you can trap an action if you want and say, and then look at the store and say, do I really need to do this? And if you don't, if the store's state says, no, someone's already called this, then you just kill that action. And the action goes nowhere. But this also is good because you can intercept an action and then make an asynchronous call, still pass the action through the dispatch loop, and then on return of that asynchronous call, if the promise is fulfilled or not, then you can dispatch another action with the return payload. And you can do this through libraries called Redux Thunk, which was originally part of Redux but separated out, and Redux Promise if you want to return promises. So this is how you use the middleware. It's really simple. You just put them in the order that you want them to execute. And this is an example of an asynchronous call with Redux Thunk. So this is an action that returns a function that gives you access to dispatch and get state, which is a function that allows you to access the store state. So in this one, if I have an API key, then go and fetch the photos. If I don't have an API key, then there's no use in fetching it, right? And then when it returns, I dispatch an action, receive photos, or the request failed. Okay, and I briefly mentioned server-side rendering. This is a problem with some libraries that that adhere to like the singleton model, but you instantiate a new version of the store each time you get a call. So you're not in danger of two calls colliding with each other and possibly leaking data that you shouldn't leak. And so you pass it to a provider component as a property, and then you call react.renderToString, which spits out HTML. And then you call store.getState to dehydrate the state and send it down to the client. And this is pseudocode. This is what you would do on the server. This uses React Router. I won't go into it too much. You can look at this code on GitHub, or you could just Google some of the examples for Redux. There are a multitude of them out there. And I also provide a Redux starter. You can go to it and get started with this. It provides you the dev tools that you need to transpile JSX and use ESX syntax. You can try it if you want. It's really simple. It's just one component. And it doesn't do much. So these are some Redux references. Two of them by Dan Abramoff, who is the author. And I really highly recommend his talk that he gave at React Europe. It's really enlightening. And that's all I got. Thanks for listening.
Are there any questions for Matt before we jump into the lightning talks? Cool. Well, thanks, Matt. That was awesome. I liked the demo too. So I'm just going to go in the order of in which I spoke to people who wanted to do lightning talks. No, you're shaking your head. You're first, right? Okay. Ted's shaking his head, but he's walking up here, so I think Ted's first. He's going to talk about Vue.js. In his words, the best JS framework that you've ever heard of.
Nobody knows.
Yeah. So we'll see what that's all about.
What's the room?
What's the room? It's going.
My son's really into Legos. What's the Kraggle? Let's go. So I've been working with Vue.js for about a year and a half. I've deployed 5 projects with it. Not exactly in love with it, but I'm kind of in denial about it as well. It's actually really easy to understand and wrap your head around. I like it for a few reasons. One, it provides a data model that basically updates the view, but allows you to use plain old JavaScript objects as the data model. If you update the data model, the view changes. There's no functions to call, there's nothing to worry about. And actually it's very accurate, and I'll show you how it's made in a minute, but it's very exact in the fact that it's using ES5's getter setter properties to actually simulate the primitives, so you actually get function calls as you manipulate data. It's 24K, it's tiny. That's smaller than jQuery, it's smaller than most of the libs out there. But it actually provides full DOM synchronization from data to view. It has no external dependencies. It is ES5, so it's IE9 or higher, and works on all mobile devices. So if you're targeting a modern browser, it just works. The current version of Vue is Vue 12.12, and actually they're in the alpha release of version 1, which should be out this year. Library is about 2 years old. So I wanted to take you through a demo of it real quick. So what Vue does is Vue uses templating that is HTML. There's nothing, you basically just write it in the DOM and you can edit it as such. It uses handlebars templating to do any of the rendering. And I'll kind of show you a demo here. I'm gonna have to type one-handed though. So I have my HTML, plain old HTML, anybody can write it, it's very straightforward. The data model is new Vue, you can see it in the center here, but I'm simply passing in a data object, which is plain old JavaScript objects, and that data becomes my data model. And this is the output of the library. So if I actually want to iterate this list, I would say v-repeat, equals to do, that equals. It's plural, to do's, there. So now we ended up having, he iterates over the two items that are in the to-dos library. And to get the content property inside of each of those objects, I simply do handlebar syntax around this. And bang, there it is. The other one is the data model has the title in here, so I can simply come in and do objects like this. And also, I can come in and go instead of title, and go leading edge. And you can see the data changes live. What's really nice about the data model is you can come in at runtime. Because the data model is demo, I can simply say demo.title equals. And so I'm changing really simple properties on a really simple API, and it's actually changing the DOM. And it's doing it incrementally, it's doing it as the data changes, and it's kind of queuing up any of the updates that I want to do. It's actually deep enough to where I can go demo.todos.push, and I can simply create an anonymous object, and I'll say done equals, done equals false, and content. And again, it's plain old JavaScript. I'm calling the push function on the array. But because the data model has wrapped the array, has wrapped that data element, when it increments, it actually pushes one item into the DOM. It doesn't iterate over and render out all of the items. It just iterates on one, which I find pretty cool. So that's the runtime API that I covered. And really, you know, that shouldn't work, but it's ES5 getter setter, so when you push the data in, it simply wraps the data model. Is that better? Cool. And basically any event you can catch before the data changes, as the data changes, and after the data changes in terms of events. So it's actually pretty deep in terms of what the feature set does. And not only that, but it actually is intended to write bigger components, so you can take any view and create a component out of it. You can actually use the web component syntax in the DOM, and actually those will call view components and basically query things up. In many ways, I like it because you can start small and get really big without using, pretty straightforward. We entered Startup Weekend Education 2 weeks ago, myself and Stephen Hahn, and in one day we actually built a complete slide editor with Vue. And basically got things working to a point where we were actually accused of cheating at the hackathon just because we had stuff working in a state that was quite high quality, and it was easy to understand and easy to go through it. So that's it. It's Vue.js, vuejs.org. My name's Ted. Thanks.
Okay, and so by the way, for anyone else who might consider doing a lightning talk or whatever, you don't have to have slides and demos and stuff like that. Ted is just an overachiever, so don't let that scare you. Justin's up next. He's gonna take the contrarian view to a lot of what we've seen here with components and things like that, and talk more about getting back to sort of the prototypal nature and functional nature of JavaScript.
All right. So, as you've seen, give me 1 second to get this on the screen. Please hold for technical difficulties.
Do you need this computer or is it on the internet?
I can do it on the internet. Yeah, that's fine. It's totally frozen.
While he's doing that, we can actually do the third thing. I think this was a quick one anyway, right?
Yeah, it's a quick one. Okay. I can use the screen or I can go without it.
Yeah, if you can, is it on the internet?
Yeah.
Why don't you just use mine? It'd be easier.
Okay.
You can't connect to these screens unless you first get on the private network and stuff. It's just quicker. I'm already connected.
All right. So how many of you guys know about Ember?
Woo-hoo.
Ooh, that is about half of you. We can give a talk later for the other people.
There you go. So.
All right. Can we get on there?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I don't need to see
it. Help if I actually connect to you, right?
All right, so the other lightning talks are giving you 1 5-minute presentation. I'm going to give you 68 5-minute presentations. Just a second. There are 68 5-minute presentations that you can look at. And the reason I made Ember screencasts is there are a lot of great introductions. There are a lot of great tutorial books that get you started. And there's really great in-depth documentation, but in between there's a middle ground where like you finish your tutorial, but you're not quite ready to be reading the API yet. And so Ember Screencast is covering that gap. We're also covering a bunch of the add-ons. Ember has a vibrant add-on ecosystem of really cool things that you can make work with Ember. And yeah, so if you're wanting to work with Ember, go there. If you're wanting to know why you should work with Ember, then I've also recorded a 30-minute presentation on that. And the other ones total about 6 hours of content. And that's it.
Okay. That was easy. It was Jeffrey, right?
Yes.
Yeah, Jeffrey.
Jeffrey, you forgot to
put
where to comment.
Oh, emberscreencast.com.
Emberscreencast.com.
I have stickers if you want that.
Yeah.
I think I got it. Yeah. Let's try that.
Yeah, just to, I didn't quite catch if you were like volunteering to speak maybe at one of our meetups. But
yes.
That was one thing, you know, for you guys that are new to the meetup, that's kind of our thing, right? So this is a perfect example tonight of there are a lot of people who might be really interested in sort of learning about React. But you may not go to a React specific meetup because they may be talking about something really specific that, you know, wouldn't interest you unless you kind of had some background. So we're all about doing sort of introductory, higher level things to give people a taste of different frameworks kind of from month to month. And we haven't talked about Ember yet.
Right,
so we'd be real interested in that.
All right. Let's see. I'm going to get mirrored here. Okay, sorry about the issues. All right, so who here, whenever they want to write some kind of, whether it be a module or a model or whatever is the M in MVC, who writes it with constructors and prototypes and show of hands. Who uses this pattern as their go-to pattern? Okay. All right, not as many as I thought. Maybe this won't be as controversial as I thought it was. We get, at least at the PayPal organization, we see this quite a bit. A lot of it is due to your classical programming styles, people coming over from Java, C++, classical languages like that. Tries to mimic the class style of programming, where you have a parent entity that you call on, usually with the new keyword, and that parent entity then provides you with a plain old object that has usually properties and methods that you can operate on. I am here to tell you that there are better ways to do this. There are others that champion this kind of idea. Eric Elliott, Kyle Simpson, among a few notable ones. There's reasons for me not being a massive fan of this pattern. One of them is, if you read the book that is nicknamed The Game of Four, but I believe it's called Design Patterns something, but it was written by four really notable engineers back in the day. Out of the whole book, there's really two main principles that are that really ring true, for me at least, whenever I'm engineering any piece of code, and that is, program to an interface, not an implementation, and favor object composition over class inheritance. And one of the reasons why I'm not a fan of this is because, to me, it breaks both of those rules. And the reason I say that is, a lot of times you will see, the constructor is, it returns an object, and then up the prototype chain, you then have all these methods, and it kind of creates a idea where you start attaching all your functions to the prototype. So what you end up doing is you end up programming to the implementation, and you don't really program to the interface. That is one thing where, there's ways around it, of course, but it's usually when you start moving in this fashion, you tend to follow it, a lot of times to the absolute extreme. So the alternative to this, so the pros of this are obviously memory efficiency, and that's for if you have a ton of methods that you need to assign to a bunch of child objects. These are up on the prototype chain, so there's really only one existence of these. All the other ones just reference this on the prototype, so each individual object doesn't have its own methods, and therefore it's very efficient in memory. The cons are it's dependent on an implicit environment, meaning that there's a lot of this dot method, this dot property, this. That it means that it has to be aware, or it has to have a knowledge of things that are outside of itself, either on the object or on the any parent class of that object. So privates are hard to achieve. Private properties and private functions are hard to achieve with this. You can do it, but it just doesn't come naturally. And it creates a little bit more of a larger, complex mental model of, let's see, does this live on this object or the one above it? Or, if I want to create a grandchild object of this with its parent and yada, 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 just gets very complicated. So to me, the alternative that is, that kind of lends itself to a much better paradigm is the module method. And by module method, I don't mean the AMD or the asynchronous module definition. I don't mean your common JS type module. What I mean is the actual design pattern of the module way of returning an object. So rather than returning an object after newing something up that has from a constructor that's then linked to a prototype, or that has a prototype linked to it, you just return a plain old JavaScript object. And so the nice thing about that is, through the beauty of closure, you have the ability to return a what you believe is to be a the best public interface, so you actually have a public API that you return, and then you can keep all of your private methods and your private properties and all that within the closure itself, so it's available to anything that is utilizing the, this API, but indirectly, right? You can very much control the environment of your API and what your consumers can do with it. So there's two things that's really cool about this. One is it relies on no implicit environment. You don't have to use a lot of this because your methods don't have to be aware of the context of itself. Through the fact of closures, you can then just call these functions and it will look within the parent function scope and be able to execute it or access these properties. So it's a much easier mental model to reason about. You have, let's see, what does that even say? It's going off the screen. So you have more flexibility left for, So whenever you have a consumer of this module, you don't have to have them worry about, do I new this thing up or can I just directly access this after I call it? So you leave it up to them. They can do an object.create on the thing that is returned, and that object that's returned then becomes the prototype, or they can just directly access it. They call it, you get the object, and they can directly start accessing the methods or the API that you provided. So, and you don't have to worry about newing things up. So you don't have to worry about your consumers being aware of your implementation. The cons, it's different. It's not what everyone else does. So you'll get a lot of pushback as to, you know, why would we use this when constructors and prototypes work perfectly fine? So, but I would suggest that you push back on that. And the reasons are you programming to an interface? I believe you are. So we passed the first rule from the Gang of Four. You're now, your implementation details are now hidden, right? You're only exposing the very API that you want to expose, and everything else is tucked away and encapsulated within that function scope. So is it composable? Yeah, it's definitely composable. Since you're returning plain old JavaScript objects, you don't have to worry about crazy inheritance chains or vertical inheritance or anything like that. You can do whatever you want with these, or your consumer can do whatever they want with these plain objects, and I will show you what I mean. So here we have a very simplistic little mix-in factory. So I have the actual modules, but they're kind of buried underneath because you've already seen them. So we're going to use this mix-in factory in a bit, but I just wanted you to kind of see what they do. They just basically copy the methods over from a from all the objects provided to it, and then it returns a final object. So here are some of the say, so here's a say hi factory that returns a say hi function. These are very contrived examples, but I just wanted you to see it. So you have then a proto hi and a proto bye. Let's see, then what you're going to do is these are, you can think of them like Node.js, where you're just doing a require. Since this isn't Node, I'm not doing a require, but you can just think of it as a require. So they are returning objects, and then down here you will have your instances, and you just do an object.create with that proto hi, and then you pass in whatever value you want for the name. Then we also have a more functional programming, so OO stands for object oriented. Functional programming, FP stands for functional programming, and I'll kind of go into why I'm doing this kind of weird stuff, but it's just to prove that these are instances of a parent object, and they do have the prototypal chain. So here you have just copy. So if you notice, I'm just doing a direct copy to it rather than having to new anything up or doing object.create. We also have here the mix-in instances. So we have a bunch of OO style or FP style. And then we have copies with the mix-ins. And this is all just, you don't have to like really look at this code very hard. It's all just examples of how much you can do with just a plain old module, the module pattern returning plain old objects. And here we're just attaching name and giving it the name that we want it to have. So here's where I prove that certain things have prototypal inheritance and certain things do not. And then I'm proving the behavior down here. So let's actually look at the console and see if I can prove my point. So if you notice on the prove prototypal inheritance, instances use prototypes? And it is true. The reason this is true is whenever you do a function is triple equal to a function, if it's pointing to the exact same reference pointer, then it is true. They are the same. So our copies, do copies use prototypes? No, they do not, and that's because you've actually copied the functionality to the objects. The mix-in instances, do they use prototypes? Yes, mix-in copies do not. And then you can see that the prove, the actual method execution, everything says hello. So everything says hello and bye-bye, and that is the proof that it works. So I guess the upside to all of this, I guess what I'm trying to say is, the module definition is a very, very simple pattern to use, but it can be extremely powerful. And it's all left to your consumer. Your consumer can use it in whatever way they want. Many times you'll create this, you know, huge vertical inheritance chains and all that, and then your consumer news up one object, uses that object, and then throws it away. So you've created this nice, beautiful class hierarchy for someone to create a single instance, use a single method on it, and then toss it in the trash when it's done executing. So it has the mental model of something simple, but you can build things very great from it. That's, I guess, all I have for today. And if you are interested in any of this, you can go to my GitHub page. It is gist.github.com/cerebral. Yes, that is cerebral without an A, which is, I guess, a play on cerebral. Anyway, so you can go here. I have a bunch of examples of kind of what I'm talking about and links out to the actual JS bin pages, so you can actually play around with what I built here and what I showed. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to come up. I will also be at the Billiards Place. I believe it is the Billiards Place. So I'll be there if you have any questions. Thank you.
All right, yeah, so that is Buffalo Billiards on the corner of 6th and Brazos, if anyone is interested. Any final questions or comments or anything before we wrap it up? From anyone? Cool. Thanks for coming out. I appreciate it. Hope to see you guys again soon. And don't forget a parking validation thing if you parked here.